So, hello everybody, and welcome to episode 9, I think this is now. So we're gonna see if we can do a connection with our Wi-Fi class, and get connected up to a router and the interwebs. A couple of things that we need to do in advance so we can see what's going on. I'll be doing this the normal, I say normal in quotes, ESP way, where we'll upload the sketch, or the project, shall I say, via UART, so by USB effectively, which is the sort of typical way that we do it with the ESP. Unfortunately, that doesn't give you debugging, or at least not yet. I can do it with JTAG. That's what I do for work, and that enables you to put breakpoints in and so on. But I'm quite conscious that most of you probably don't have that ability or the equipment to do that. So we'll try and keep it as sort of vanilla as possible, as it were. So with that in mind, we need to put some stuff in so we can see what's going on. And we've already had a bit of a hint. We'll just use the UART logging that's provided by Espressif, and we can read that straight back from the same bus that we get that we program it over. So the same USB. So if you're in Windows, COM port. If you're on Linux, a TTY or whatever. But at the moment, I think the only log message we've got in this Wi-Fi class is for an unexpected event. And hope if I scroll through, yeah, I can't see any others there at least. Yeah, no. So unless we get an unexpected event, we're not going to really have a clue what's going on. So let's basically put in a bunch of logging that we can use. For the interim, and eventually when everything's working, and we'll turn the logging off. Simple reason is that these calls pumping over a USB bus at 11.5200 baud, yeah, it's quite slow, so it's going to slow down your program quite a lot, and all these strings as well is going to take up some memory. Just for this class is not going to be a lot and not really a huge concern, but over the scope of an entire project, it adds up. And if you're trying to do stuff fast or time critically or on battery power, you don't want to be wasting your time when this is deployed out in the field and you don't actually have anything connected to that logging bus, that serial port, COM port, whatever it is. But as I say, for the interim, let's basically put an absolute ton of logging in here. So this isn't going to be hugely pretty. We'll do everything as info because that should get published, and we'll define a log tag. So the way that the ESP logging works is you give it two strings of it. Effectively, the second string is a standard printf type arrangement, so it's a variadic argument. So you can have multiple arguments on this and use percents to inject it in. Not a million miles away from how Python does it if you're fluent in Python. But this tag is basically goes at the start of the log message, so you can see who it is that's actually logging it. Typically when you see ESP projects, they'll have right at the start of the file hash define. Oops. Nope, typing's no better today. Normally tag, I think they call it, and then they'll say, like Wi-Fi or something like that. Hash defines are fine, you can use them. Follows the one definition rule, so it'll all get optimized. It's a define, so it'll get put in on each instance, but it'll get optimized and it'll be a one definition. You should only ever get one definition of this string in your code, so it's not going to get heavy doing it that way. But let's try and do it the C++ way. You'll see just below where I'm typing now, that we've got a router set up, SSID Green Giant test and password Green Giant. This is exposed to the internet at the moment, but yeah, you won't get on it unless you're outside my house and know where I live, and I only turn it on when I'm doing this, these videos anyway. I have a different one for work and stuff like that, so you're not going to hack me in. And good luck trying if you wish to give it a go. Okay, so we will say log tag, and we'll call it Wi-Fi. We'll do low. No, we'll do camel case, because I've got a feeling the driver uses Wi-Fi as its internal log tag. Just want to be able to differentiate if that is the case. So that's the C++ way of doing it, and we can just paste that in here. As I say, it doesn't really make any difference, to be honest. But I want to avoid using compiler definitions, so hash defines and things like that. It's the old C way of doing it. I say the old C way. I mean, C is still very, very prevalent in embedded. I think it is still the most prevalent, so I'm not down talking C by any stretch. So what we'll do is we'll have a format that we're happy with, and we'll just say, right, waiting for mutex, waiting for init mutex, and then we'll give it func. He says, after saying he's not going to use any compiler ones, underscore underscore func underscore underscore is a compile time definition, and it basically gives you the function that you're currently in. There's other ones. There's capital if you use func, that'll give you something slightly different, and there's also pretty function, I think it is. No, it might just be pretty func, which gives you a slightly unmangled one. But we'll just use func. It's always sort of works fairly well for me. So what we'll expect is we'll expect Wi-Fi, and then we'll expect the function name, and then whatever message we want to log. And in fact, actually, this is in the constructor, so I don't actually care about that so much. That'll be a bit more obvious. But these ones we do care about. So let's just copy and paste in here. Got a Wi-Fi event. And then in this one, got an IP event. You know what would actually be useful is not just the function. So I might as well show you a few little bits and bobs, and this is where this string's going to get a little bit messy now. But if we add a %d there, so we're going to inject a signed integer, we can also do line. So we'll get the function name, colon, and then the line. You can also do file and so on. There's loads of compile time directives that you can give it. Let's just make sure that compiles before we do anything else, before I start copying and pasting this out. And actually, we can put that down here as well. So we're using the same format. Now what you probably want to do is just create a logging function, so you're not having to copy and paste all this. You can just call your log function, and it automatically injects the line and the file and so on, because this is going to get long if we start wanting to add extra information in here. This starts getting quite unwieldy. So that looks like it has compiled, which is good because that means I've typed it all in correctly. Yep, that's looking good. So we can get rid of that. So it's all following the same sort of format now. That's quite nice. And then we'll do, so we know it's the Wi-Fi event handler, event ID, and then we'll do %d. Of the event ID, there we go. And again, we can just copy and paste that down into here. Doesn't matter which order it is because we're putting the past parameter in here rather than this. Again, we could write a little lookup that converts. So if we just look at IP event, that converts these into a string, or at least we give it the number. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and it returns a string that says these words. So rather than it printing out event ID 1, it will print out event ID, IP event station lost IP, for example. And we'll do that in the fullness of time, but we'll keep it simple for the time being. So we'll do got IP waiting for state mutex. And then we'll do connected. And then we'll do waiting for IP. Oh, this is for lost IP. We're probably not going to get this. And let's change that one to a warning. It's not strictly a warning, but doesn't matter. And then this will definitely be a warning. Default switch case. Okay, so we've added a bit of login into our IP event handler. We need to add some into our Wi-Fi event handler. Waiting for state mutex, and then we'll do ready to connect, ready to connect. And then here, last one, stay connected, waiting for state mutex. I shouldn't have deleted all that, should I? State mutex, and I'm putting that in. You'll see why it's useful to put little debugs around mutexes and semaphores and so on, because if we get stuck here waiting for a mutex that's never been given, and we never take it, you sat there just and your program's hanging, you don't understand why it's hanging. Whereas if you put this debug message first, you know it's hanging on in this function, in this line, because we are sat here waiting for this and it never arrives. So we'll say waiting for IP. Lovely. And then I'm just going to do default switch case. Now this one definitely will fire. So let's just put in a %d there, and then event ID. This one will fire because I know this one will fire if we go to this enum. So when it's ready, we're not handling that because we don't care. It doesn't matter to us in the way we've coded it. Start we are handling, and connected we are handling. Start and connected. There may be an auth mode change. Possibly not, not sure. But then there may be some sort of other things, that events that happen that we don't really care about. So I'm expecting this one to fire. We can have a look at the numbers and see what actually got triggered and what we did, what we ignored, and see if that is actually still a valid valid assumption. And I'm just going to copy that down to here. So we've got the same thing. If we get an IP6 event or something like that, we'll be able to see that there. Okay, let me just get my copy. Yeah, okay, so this will be begin, and this will be waiting for connect. Mutex, this will be waiting for state mutex, this will be calling ISP Wi-Fi connect. Simple as that. And then, right, okay, so this is a good one, and you'll see this code a lot. So we'll do %s because we're going to pass it a string. Let me just pull this down onto a new line so it's a bit more readable. And then we're going to do ESP error to name, and then we're going to pass it status. So what this function does, really, really handy little function, we sort of mentioned what would be useful is to have a function that converts this from a number to the words ready to connect. This is effectively what the ESP error to name function does, but just for error messages. So we'll expect ESP Wi-Fi connect colon, whoops, and then if all went well, colon ESP, the words ESP OK, rather than its enum value, which is a zero. You know, they've done some of the heavy lifting for you there, and we'll be able to see if that's sort of done the right thing. And let's just put one down here for the error state. And let's just, for the time being, just call it error state. That's bad doing that because it doesn't really give much of the game away. We'd really want to pass it, print out which of these states we're actually in, because I've done this as a strongly typed enum. That's not as trivial to do. We can't just put %d, that won't compile, because this isn't an integer, it's a state e type. But anyway, we'll worry about that later. So we're waiting for the init mutex. I'm just going to copy and paste this down. Again, lots of copying and pasting, which should ring alarm bells for you if you ever have to do this, that there's probably a better way. And there is, and we've sort of discussed that. But this is temporary, so I'm not too bothered. And then we'll do calling ESP netif init. And then we'll do, where's that error to name? Is that one? So there we go. We'll print out the what this returned. And then we've got a few more API calls, and we'll just follow the same format here. Call in netif create default station, blah, blah, blah. Now this is returning a pointer. So we can't do an error to name on this. So what we'll do is we'll just do %p and then we'll pass it this. And that'll point out the address of this that this pointer is pointing to. So if this is zero, if we get, you know, ESP netif create default station colon zero, we know this failed because it returned a null or a null pointer. And we'll just follow this same format. Come on, auto indent, play with me here. We'll use the status one for this. And remember to change our text. Sorry, that's my phone going off. Oops, one too many. Calling, oh no. Let's just learn how to type, shall we? There we go. That's probably all of them. Calling event handler register. This string, as I say, is getting rather lengthy and ugly and horrible. Told you it would. Oh, this is the same here. Now, this is okay to have the same message, exactly the same message printed out here. Only, oh, hello. What did I press there? There we go. Only because we have this. Underscore underscore line. So when we read the debug message, we'll be able to differentiate between this call and this call. So it'll either be line 209, well, it won't be 209, it'll be 208, or it'll be 220. So in this case, that's not actually a problem. But just something to be aware of. If you're doing this and you've not done the underscore underscore line thing, then it's possibly a better idea to have distinct error messages that you can search for, so there's no confusion as to which one you're looking at. So calling set mode, we've got a bit of a mem copy there, don't particularly care about that. So we'll do one of them and we'll do one of them. So yeah, this is a bit dull, lots of copying and pasting here, but once it's in, it should be a set and forget. Oh, I've done a copy and paste here wrong, haven't I? Who spotted it? Was it that one, or have I done it further up? Nope, it was just this one. Calling. So we'll copy that. There we go. And ESP Wi-Fi start, lovely. I think that is more or less the last one. ESP Wi-Fi start. And then finally, oh, do we have the state change mutex at the top of this? Oh yeah, we do, that's fine. Initialized, and here failed, and we'll make that an error. So get Mac is going to return that. Okay, that's probably all right for now. So we need to now create an instance of this class and set it running. So we can then actually flash it to our ESP. So at the moment, this is still from ages ago. It's not changed. So what we need to do is make sure we're in the CMake list. No, we're not. So we need to add our Wi-Fi. So that's the folder name here that contains a CMake list to our main one. So we'll close that, and that will then allow us to include Wi-Fi. Dot H, which is this one here. I'm just going to set this build in while we continue. The namespace was capitals Wi-Fi and the class is lowercase Wi-Fi. Okay, that's fine. And for the time being, let's just remind ourselves what the constructor does. The constructor gets a mutex, does calls all of this, which is fine to do in a constructor. Okay, so that's fine then. So we'll do Wi-Fi. It compiled at the bottom, that's good. And we'll call it Wi-Fi, why not? There we are, lovely. So this will get constructed when the main class gets constructed, so that's fine. So what did we need to call? What are our public things that we need to do? Init and begin. So let's go to main. So in state in here, we can do wi-fi.init and we're ORing it together. So if either of these fails, it'll throw a message. And then we'll do. Then what will we do? We might as well call begin straight away once VS Code is unhanged. I think it's because I've just been working on a remote project. If ESP okay is equal to status, oops, then we'll call Wi-Fi, we'll do status ORed with Wi-Fi dot begin like that. So we know that Wi-Fi dot init is safe to call multiple times. Is Wi-Fi begin safe to call multiple times? I can't remember. Hopefully it is. Let's find it. Scrolly, scrolly, scroll. Yes, it is. Yes, because we're changing our state within that function. Okay. And if the setup succeeds, we jump into our loop. So it's very Arduino-y. We'll get a hello world, and our LED will do some blinking and stuff like that. So let's compile that. While it's doing that, we'll set our port. So select port to use. We're on port 6, I think. I've got my little TTGO with a screen on it. Still never actually done anything with the screen yet. Linking, so that's normally a good sign. And we'll click build, flash, and monitor. Oh, so there we go, flashing away. Ignore the phone. Boom. Right. Lots of stuff happened here. Ah, but we actually passed. All right. So let us scroll through this. So heap init, we don't care about any of that. Wi-Fi in the camel case. Here we are. Wi-Fi. Waiting for init mutex. And we got another message after that, which means it succeeded. Here's the function name. Here's the line number that we talked about. So that's really, really good. Calling netifinit. Netifinit returned ESP OK. Creating the station. That returned a valid, or at least a pointer that isn't null. That's good. Calling Wi-Fi init. Then the driver prints out a load of bumf. And then our next print statement here, init returned ESP OK. So that's good. Got the event handlers, so on and so forth. Setting mode. So that's all our init stuff done. And then Wi-Fi start. And then we get initialized. So our state's changed. So if we remember where we're actually doing that, at the bottom of our init function, we know that because it's init here. Sorry, this line, isn't it? And it's line 270. So if we just scroll all the way down to 270, here we can see that is that log message that got printed out, with func being the init function and line being 270 there. So that's our state change. Next thing that happens is in the begin method. So begin has been called. Line 136, waiting for the connect mutex. So we can go up to line 136. This is where this is really, really good for logging. So this is the top of our begin method. Then we wait for the state mutex. But what before that happens, we get a Wi-Fi event happen here. So this is where you've got to concern yourself with different threads. So whilst we were waiting for the connect mutex, another thread executed some code and we got a Wi-Fi event ID 2. So if we go to our Wi-Fi event handler, let's just F12 onto that, ID 2 is the station start event, which we can see here. And we've actually printed that out. So waiting for the state mutex. So this is where you can see this is quite important. If this had fired ever so slightly later, we would have had this thread, so the Wi-Fi event handler, trying to change the state whilst our begin method was trying to read it. But because we've put these guards on here, these mutexes, it means that only one can access it at once. So it enables one thread to update the value and then release itself. And then the other thread can read the value rather than it trying to happen at the same time, which can cause funniness with caching and so on, where the CPU has got old data. So it thinks it's not in the ready to connect state, even though that connect state's just been set, because it prefetched that value, for example, and at that time when it was prefetched, it wasn't in the ready to connect state. It was in the connecting state, I think it would have been in this instance. So you would get some really odd behavior. So putting mutexes on it, as we can see now, has saved us here. And then we get ready to connect, calling Wi-Fi connect, returned ESP OK. And now we're looking for an IP event. Oh, so station connected. So we connected to the router. So now we're waiting for the DHCP service to give us an IP address. And would you look at that? A few seconds later, after the LED's done some more blinking, we get the driver telling us that the netif handler fired. And then our code, the IP event handler fired. So if we go down to the IP event handler that we wrote here, event ID 0. So let's just F12 onto this. So you can see, you know, event ID 0 doesn't tell you very much. So actually having some sort of lookup for these that prints out a string would be a lot more useful. Got an IP address is the event that was that fired. So then we can set our state to connected. And we can see the driver's actually printed out our IP address, the mask and the gateway and so on. So yeah, you can see I'm not on 192.168. Come at me, brah. And that's all that happens. We're connected now. So we are connected. We've got an IP address. This seems to work. We wouldn't have got an IP address if it didn't work. So what, if we think about what that's telling us, it would be really nice to connect to something over Wi-Fi and and send a packet and receive a packet just to confirm, you know, we could have Putty up and running or something. But we've not implemented any of that. We've not implemented UDP or TCP or any of that stuff yet. We just wanted to see, can we connect and can we get an IP address? Which shows that not only is the ESP talking to the router and sending the correct packets and receiving the correct packets so that it connects to the router, can connect to the router okay, but also it's showing us that we've managed to connect to the DHCP server, send it some data, and I'll tell you now, my DHCP server isn't on the router, it's on another device. I have Pi-hole running basically. So that's showing some network traffic communication going on, and we've been able to send and receive packets. So I didn't test this, which before I made this video, we're doing it live. So it's really nice when code works the first time. I'll tell you now, that's a rare occurrence. No matter how good you are, that's a rare occurrence. But really, we had the example project to go off. All right, we've written it slightly differently to the example project, but we had the reference, so you know we've done everything there. So this is really exciting. I'll get this committed and pushed up. I've just realized I've not enabled the YouTube auto comments subtitles. For some reason, the auto subtitles doesn't work, so I have to. After it has generated the subtitles, which takes some time, I have to download them as a whatever file extension that is and re-upload them. It's really odd. I don't know why it's doing that. But anyway, doing it that way seems to then work. So I'll do that and go back and do the other videos as well before I get shouted at in the comments. So my apologies there, troops. So hope you found this interesting. So next video, we want to extend this and give it some interesting functionality. What you'll see here in this log message, so we've got an I, so that's because it's an information log message, and that's because it's a log I. If we scroll up, can we find a warning? Or has it gone off the top? No, that's a low level. No, we haven't actually had a warning or an error. But basically, this will be a W for a warning and it would be yellow, E for error and it would be red, and debug, if we had that enabled, would be a D and the text would be white. And you can turn various levels on and off. We haven't done any of that yet. But we'll extend this functionality and we'll get SNTP working. So we'll connect to an offsite time protocol server. Somewhere on the internet, and we'll get the real world time and date as it is at the time of runtime. And that'll change this number from milliseconds since boot, and this will automatically update and say today's date and time, which is really, really useful, particularly if it's running offsite and you're logging this to an SD card or something. Time since boot's not particularly helpful. Particularly if it's rebooting every now and then or dropping in and out of deep sleep or something like that, this number very quickly becomes completely irrelevant. But today's date and time is actually quite useful to know, and you can use that as a timestamp if you're then sending information up to a server. So say you're logging the temperature outside, rather than attaching time since boot, which means absolutely nothing, you can attach the date and time that that temperature reading was taken. That's quite useful. You could get the server to do it, so on receipt of the message, it just sticks the time and date on. But say you wanted to take readings every minute, so you're waking up from deep sleep every minute, you take a reading and you save it to non-volatile. And then every hour, you then connect to the Wi-Fi, which uses quite a lot of power. Send all the data at once that you've had saved, which is timestamped correctly. And then disconnect the Wi-Fi so you can save some power and go back to just doing sensor readings every minute. So this is the sort of thought process we'll go for. So we'll get SNTP up and running so we get time. The other thing I want to do is set up the smart config. We talked about this before. It enables you to connect with your phone using one of the Espressif apps, and it goes through a weird protocol, but basically you can send it your Wi-Fi SSID and password. But to enable that to be particularly useful, we need to implement the non-volatile storage so we don't have to do that each time we reboot. So that's the things to look forward to. Hope you enjoyed this one, and I'll see you soon.